Welcome back to Paz Pod, Phil. How you doing?
Good mate, yeah, very good. How are you?
Yeah, all right, mate. All right. Nice Friday, and it's relatively sunny, even though my blinds are quite clearly closed behind me. Bit chilly. Went out for a walk this morning,
It
but
was a bit cold this morning, wasn't it?
managed to return the really, really tight jeans I wanted to. How was your week been? Good training sessions this week.
Yeah, lots of running. My legs are a bit tired. It's good. We just need to keep at it, and obviously we'll start serious stuff in July. Keep the lads coming up and enjoying themselves, I think, and then we'll see where we are when we get to actual pre-season.
You know, you say serious stuff. Now, we've been doing a lot of running. Are we going to have to do like a lot of fitness in July?
Having looked at some people, yes, would be my answer.
Well, maybe I'll have to join in that because obviously tomorrow or
Tomorrow.
today, when this goes out, you're joining me along with Theo and the wet denim kench of George Billum, supposedly, if he isn't too drunk for tonight, to do the 5K.
Yeah.
How are you excited for the 5K? Because I think I need your enthusiasm to potentially get me excited again for the 5K.
Oh, I'll be all over it, mate. I'll lead from the front and
I can just imagine me getting back to yours 10 minutes after everyone else is finished, and you just like sat there with a Corona, knocking them back.
we'll all stick together, don't we? I won't leave you behind. But
That's right. I'll run behind like you and Theo, so I'll get the
yeah,
clean air to run
you want
into.
the slipstream, are you?
Yeah, that's. I'm hoping. If I'm hoping as well, you don't notice that I wear my Heelys, so I can just scoot along behind you now and again.
It is all flat, so you're not going to get too much benefit out of that.
No, but for avid listeners of the pod and those who follow me, if you want to donate to that as well, we can put the link out tomorrow. Along with, we'll reshare the link. I'm getting good at these. Reshare the link for Little Dragons as well in Myanmar.
Indeed.
So I know we're asking for a lot of money, but we're not. We're asking you to give a lot of money. We're not getting any of this unless you'd like to give us money, and then I'm not sure either of us will say no.
No, I mean, I'm quite upset with my bank account details on below. If somebody wants to give me money as well, that's fine.
I'm more likely to put our bank account details on there to remember to put a link up for a GoFundMe page. Because I'm just not because I don't like charity, just because I'm greedy. Lucky this week, good pod.
Was very interesting. He's still a very young lad.
I
I forget
forget how
how.
young he is. Yeah.
He's got the body of an abusive drunk. So I think he's an entertaining character. He's always got a smile on his face, and it was nice to have a decent conversation with him.
That type of person who often quite smiley because that's what they say, isn't it? They're quite jolly, the larger round of people. There was a few comparisons you hit on, which I did like, especially liked the Simpsons accent you did, but people will have to wait to hear that. But there's, I was thinking this maybe each guest we get on, we need to find a similar character from a
Simpsons
film.
character, just a
Just similar Simpsons characters.
who would you be?
Me? I don't know. I think I probably.
Got to be the cartoon guy, surely. Comic book guy.
Oh, but he's a bit of a. I was going to say he's a bit of a weirdo, but that doesn't help my cause because I'm a bit of a weirdo, really. Maybe if you took me back a year, maybe Barney Gumble. Maybe he's
Yes, yeah, I can see that.
not too dissimilar. I mean, who would you like to be? Because I, as much as it would boost your ego, Duff Beer Man, I could see actually working because of the chins and everything. So without boosting your ego, I think that's who you'd be.
It's going to be that or like one of the aliens, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, one of the aliens. I'm trying to think now what else, who are other characters are in there, but I mean this isn't a podcast about Simpsons, but we could literally go forever. Ollie Hunter would definitely
Oh, definitely.
but yeah, watch out for the one Simpsons reference, which we tried to drag out for 3 minutes of an introduction. Shall we get into the pod?
Let's do that.
Cool.
Yeah,
Right, here we are. Lockie, how are you doing?
Yeah, good, thanks.
I need to apologise about spelling your name wrong, supposedly. I do apologise, but that's all done now. How's your day been, mate?
Yeah, all right. Just been at work and then just went to the gym and just got back. So,
putting in the extras. Fair enough. Sitting in a lovely compromising position there. Let's see how long until them demands move and we get a goot shot. But for those who don't know you, you played at Pads from a young age. Went to Welbeck College, played Nottingham Academy. You recently went on a trip to New Zealand, which I'm sure we'll come on to. Just starting with a question, though, if that's all right. Is it true that you were made when the Michelin Man and the Pillsbury Flower Doll had a one-night stand?
I can confirm that's true.
That's true. Well, yeah. I mean, they would be proud of you. but when did you start playing rugby and what got you into it?
So I started playing rugby as probably like a 4 or 5 year old. Nottingham Rugby. Down at Lady Bear. Well, it wasn't at Lady Bear at the time. I can't remember where it was. Just as like a, I don't know, I was obviously quite a big lad. So my dad took me down with my brother and we played for probably, I don't know, 3 or 4 years from then on. And then a lot of, like, you probably don't know, but I did a lot of BMX race when I was a kid.
Oh,
BMX. I can't imagine you on a BMX.
I'll have to send you some pictures, to be fair. So I did that. That ended up taking over my Sunday. So I ended up not playing rugby till about year 5 or 6, just the end of primary school. And I went back to Paviers with a mate who played at Paviers at the time and just been there ever since.
So let's chat back to you on the BMX.
Yeah.
What got you into that? And is that why Kieran now likes his bicycles? Because he wants to be you?
My cousin went down. Do you know where there's a BMX track in Bullwell?
Yeah.
Yeah.
My cousin lives there and he went down and my uncle told my dad, like, you should take the lads down. It's good fun. And I went down and I was pretty good. So I ended up doing that for like, till I was probably about 13, 14. And that was obviously taking over my weekend. So.
Nice. how did you do BMX racing with stabilizers on?
Oh, I ended up taking them off, to be fair. So.
That's more than I can do. Pretty proud of you on that. So we'll go back to rugby. It feels like the BMXing, you were just good at it, which is annoying because it'd have been fun if you weren't good at BMXing. Did you have a rugby idol when you were playing growing up?
To be honest, I didn't really watch that much rugby as when I was younger. I just played it because I just ended up going down and playing. I didn't really start watching rugby and sort of getting into it till I was probably about 15.
Mm.
At the time, I was just playing for playing's sake, you know, because I was enjoying it.
Who was when around the 15 when you started watching it, who was playing at the time? Who were the kind of people that you thought, if they can do it, I can do it?
I just started I was in like the DPP setup so I just started supporting Leicester a bit and just sort of like watching a bit of Leicester and just a bit of Dan Cole. I've always liked a bit of Dan Cole in my life, to be fair. So just whatever. What just
so you're watching Leicester in their heyday, as opposed to watching them now. I guess it's not the most exciting team. I guess it's one of them, isn't it? We speak to people about who their idols were, but if you start playing from a young age, I guess you do just play because you're into it. It's those who have kind of not started or picked up a rugby tournament until they're like 15, 16, like especially. Kind of my age, it was the A3 World Cup that got a lot of people into it and stuff like that. That's fair enough. How would you describe your playing style? Because I know how I describe it. I want to know how you describe your playing style first.
Probably like... That's a tricky one, to be fair. I'm trying to... I don't know. Probably... I'd like... I'm probably a bit of a set piece kind of guy, but I'd describe myself as Dane Coles, but definitely not. So, bit of a set piece specialist. I'll put it that way.
set piece. Would you agree, Phil?
I think so, yeah. For a prop, he's relatively mobile.
And, mobile. Lovely hands as well.
He can pass. Yeah, he can pass, which is quite nice.
Compared
I do remember when he played against South Leicester last year and made a line break and pulled his hammy. That was quite funny.
Pulled a hammy on a line break.
Great line break. Was going for the line. Don't know whether you scored or not. I can't remember whether you...
Yeah, as I scored, I pulled my hamstring.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a long way to the floor when you're 5 foot one.
You are kind of shaped like a rugby ball a bit, aren't you?
Yeah, a little. Just, I've been trying to figure that out and become more like a cricket bat, if that makes sense.
No.
No. More wooden. What are you on about?
A bit more, just a bit more, bit narrower.
A bit taller.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how you're going to get a bit taller, lot, mate, if I'm honest.
Well, we'll go thinner then, not taller.
Thinner, not taller. Fair enough. I've not obviously played with you, but training with you, it's quite clear that you know what to do with ball in hand, which is quite impressive because you are, I guess, a new age front row when you look at what's going on in the world of rugby now. You do like throwing a ball around. I guess you just pretend you're a centre some of the time, don't you?
Most of the time.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we all like claiming we're centres. So New Zealand, what happened in New Zealand? What got you there in the first place and what got you back?
So what got me there in the first... I went to Stanford sixth form, Stanford School, and the coach there put me on to... just one of his friends in New Zealand that coached at Massey Rugby Club, which is in North Harbour, which is just north of Auckland.
Mm-hmm.
And there's previous Stanford like lads who have gone over and played there. So he's like, if anyone wants to go over before like a year out of uni or just whenever, you're more than welcome. So he put us in contact with two other mates from school. We flew over. We didn't really know much about it. We just saved up and booked a flight and was told everything would be sorted when we got there. got there start of, what was it, 2020, like January 2020. Stayed there for 3 months, did a bit of travelling the North Island, played all the pre-season games for Massey. And then obviously COVID kicked in. And it was sort of a risky time. Work was cancelled and I ended up coming home because of that. So it was a bit of a... I was supposed to stay till September, but I ended up coming home, was it late March? So kind of got rid of it. Hoping to go back out there at some point.
Yeah. I think it's one of them. I mean, when we were talking to Hannah the other day, it definitely sounds like a decent place to go and... Yeah. Spend some time. But I think a lot of us would suggest you come back and play rugby for Pavs relatively if you do go out again. So what was it like pre-season over in New Zealand? Because wasn't it pretty fucking hot most of the time?
Yeah, it was like... Well, it was... A lot of the time it wasn't too... So it was probably like 20 degrees, so it was hot. But it was just really humid and sweaty. And we did loads of running. Like, I was probably the fittest I've ever been. Just running. And it was like, there were lads that was bigger than me and looked way more immobile that were just unbelievably fit.
Hmm.
It was good though. Like, I enjoyed it. But I figured out they could, like, I don't know if it was just the games I played, but like, no one could scrummage very well.
Oh, really?
Yeah, just the games I played, but it was like everyone was really quick and mobile, but they just couldn't scrimmage very well.
They don't focus a lot on set piece over there until they get to the high levels. It's all skills and fitness and, you know, mobility based. And then when you get into your sort of, even at like the, what's it called? The Mitre 10s or whatever it is nowadays. They don't really focus on scrummaging. Like, the reason one team will be good at scrummaging is because they've got two massive half-Tongan props, but it's not like they're key focus out there, which kind of shows in the Super Rugby and stuff where, you know, they chuck the ball in and chuck it around a bit rather than fanning yeah, around.
It's just tell by like when he went to training and stuff, everyone was a bit more, not a bit more clued up on skills, but they're just willing to throw the ball about a bit more, which I enjoyed, to be fair.
Yeah, it does sound like that's a bit of you, to be fair, yeah. Throwing the ball around and seeing what you can get up to.
Yeah, definitely.
Were there any games in the preseason that you played that kind of stood out for you?
Yeah, well, one of them, I had a bit of a nightmare. I played against Auckland Uni in a and before the game started, we had a gazebo just on the sideline and it blew over from the floor and hit me in the head and like head open at the back. And then I went on, I strapped my head up with a big bandage around, played the game and got concussion in the game. So it was a bit of a memorable slash non-memorable day.
Yeah, sounds like you're lucky to remember any of that day.
Yeah.
If I'm honest.
But, I'm just trying to think. We played a team a bit south of Auckland in a pre-season game. And I don't know if you watch much Super Rugby, but I'm not going to be able to pronounce it, but Gerard Cowley Pooty or something. He's a second rower for the Blues.
Oh, right, yeah.
His younger brother, Poey, played for Massey, and so did he. That was their home club. So he played in one of the games when he wasn't playing for the Blues, which was pretty mega.
Yeah.
So I ended up playing with him. And then the PC brothers that used to play at Northampton, their home club was Massey as well. So they were at training 1 week, which was pretty mad.
Mate, incredible that.
Yeah, it's the best thing about rugby over there is you just do get all the like class players filtering back down to club level.
Yeah.
So good.
You see it, don't you, where you'll see that like someone's just been snapped playing rugby for their local, their home team, and then that's it, and they just kind of run the show because that's how they are. Is it a big difference from the step up? Is it a bigger difference in New Zealand than it is here?
Well, I only sort of played the pre-season game, so I didn't get to play any like Premier Rugby because as the first game started, it was like that was the weekend COVID sort of hit and everything got locked down. So I couldn't really compare it to like a Pavia's sort of first team game, but like from what I could tell at training and stuff, and the pre-season games, it was very good.
Yeah.
Probably, I think it's just quicker, isn't it?
Yeah, it was just quicker. It was very, like, it was just different.
Have you played much against Kiwis, Phil?
Or Kiwis? Not really. At schoolboy level, so I went to Australia when I was 16 and played in a tournament where we played we played Auckland High School, which is like one of the best rugbying schools in New Zealand. And we played Otago Boys as well, I think, Otago Boys High School, which were not as good. And we actually beat them relatively comfortably, I seem to remember. But yeah, I played for a representative side, so we were a pretty good team. But the Auckland High School Boys team was just ridiculous. In fact, one of the Ionis, I don't think he turned pro, but one of the Ioni brothers was playing in that team. And he was like, we were 16 and he was taller than me and obviously a hell of a lot faster as well, and he was playing at 12 and just absolutely terrorised us. So that's the only experience I got, and it was, you know, Auckland High were just unbelievable, and the Otago team were a lot more physical but not quite as good, and we beat them relatively comfortable. But there was you play each team twice in this tournament, and we seemed to get on with the Auckland lads fine because we were quite accepting that they were better than us. But we beat the Otago people lads first quite comfortably, and they took that as like a, you know, dishonourable gesture on our part to beat a New Zealand team. So in the second time we played them, they all lined up on the halfway line and did their haka, and then I think we put 40 on them in 20 minutes each way. So yeah, one of them was class, one of them wasn't.
Fair play.
Yeah, I mean, if you're lining up to do the hack and then you get shifted 40, then a bit fucking embarrassing, isn't it?
I think there was a massive scrap in that game as well, I seem to remember.
Is it very scrappy if they're at all in rugby, or is it not really? Is it they just kind of try and still look pretty and play rugby?
I thought everyone was pretty nice, to be fair. I don't know, everyone seemed quite laid back. Not when they were playing. I don't know, maybe it just wasn't, maybe because it was just pre-season and the games weren't too serious, but it all seemed pretty laid back, to be fair.
I think the idea is just play at such a high intensity that you don't have the energy to fight.
Yeah.
There's not the time because the ball's already gone.
Yeah. So you need if you're having a fight, you're about 50 metres behind the play by the time you finish.
Yeah. All right, let's move on to some of the fun stuff then. Not that that chat was boring, but we did have a question come in. I can't remember who it was off the top of my head, but tell us about the Lambs tour.
Oh, yeah. I was playing at school and then I went to these Lambs trials that a few lads had done the year before. Ended up doing all right. Got myself in there, selected for the tour. We went to South Africa. And it was a sick week and a half, to be fair. We played all like this. We went to a tournament at Kingswood College, I think it was called. And played, they had like a pre-season tournament there. So we played like all the good schoolboy teams there. And it was so good. Like all the, I don't know if it was because they were local, but then all the local teams brought like their school and they'd like stand on the pitch side in these like big stands. And they'd all have like school songs and like little, like, so there's a massive crowd and there was all the other teams there. So that was pretty sick. And then we went down to Cape Town and played Stellenbosch Academy. We're supposed to play like Western Cape, I think it's called. It was like a really good side, but then we ended up playing Stellenbosch Academy, which were decent. And yeah, it was just a good laugh to me. It was like, I thought it was going to be more serious, but it was a good laugh and like all right level rugby, so it was good.
So Western Province rather than Western Cape.
Yeah, that's it. Western Province. Yeah, we were supposed to play. I don't know, something happened and then we ended up playing, like rearranging the fixture for someone else.
How old were you when you went over?
Pardon?
How old were you when the tour was there?
It was in year 13, so I was just 17, nearly 18. So,
what's the Lambs then? You'll have to explain to us what the Lambs are.
Basically, it's all the independent schools.
All the high school as well. Why are they asking the question?
and they play against like before they go on tour, we played against London Scottish and then Irish Exiles. So yeah.
Fucking posh.
All right, as long as I didn't miss out, that's all I was worried about.
Well, was I not invited? Says Phil. Because you didn't go to a independent school, Philip. Any boozing out there at the time?
Yeah, we went out. We went out one of the nights in Cape Town, which was quite mental. To be fair, like it was proper rough. Yeah. We were on the way home, and someone had their phone out, like in the front of the taxi, and this guy just ran in and robbed his phone from like in the taxi because the window was open. Quite an eventful night. Yeah, it was good.
Yeah, there's a few stories I've heard of people going over to SA on like Lions tours and England tours and stuff, and quite quickly getting things pickpocketed out. And I think Dave was one of them that said that. But yeah, I mean, it comes with that. But also, I mean, I've not been. One of my aunties is South African, and we've got an office over there. But it like Cape Town itself looks beautiful, to be fair, and the surrounding. But it's quite cheap, isn't it? To enjoy yourself out there.
Yeah, we went to a bar on one of the nights and it was something, it worked out like £1 a pint. So we just ended up having more than a few cheap beers, to be fair, so.
Jesus. Pocket money, £1 a beer. Fucking mint.
It was only 17 and we were sort of coaches we didn't know, so we didn't necessarily... I wasn't too much boozing.
See, that's when the coaches got serious about things like that, Phil.
I went on an England tour, mate, an England counties tour, and we were told it was serious. So we got to Canada, got to Newfoundland and landed. I didn't realise that it would be -5 in Newfoundland. So rocking up in shorts and t-shirt was a really bad idea. In my head, I'm like, oh, I'm in England tour. It's going to be well serious. So I go into my room and I'm sharing with a guy from Moseley. And it was the skipper as well. So I was like, oh, I've got to be good because I'm with the skipper. Anyway, I've also got an exam. I got my last exam for uni on the next morning at like 6 a.m. or something. I had to take this exam to do it at the same time as people were doing it in Durham. And he was like, all right, come on then, let's go. I was like, is there a meeting or something? And he was like, yeah, we're going to go have a few beers. And I was like, I thought we had training tomorrow. And he was like, I don't worry about that. Anyway, I had to leave them in this bar because I was quite aware that I had my last exam to do the next day. But I must have had a fair few and went to bed and woke up after about. But they all rocked in as I was getting up to go to bed. Go to my exam. That was the first night away on an England tour. It was ridiculous.
Did you get a decent grade?
Let's just say that the chap who moderated my exam was unaware that it wasn't an open book. And I'll say no more.
I'd love it now if someone had picked this up and it gets retracted and you have to go back and sit your last exam because you're a big fucking cheap.
Well, to be fair, that university could not finger me anymore.
No. All right. Yeah, true. Golden boy. Lockie, before we move on to kind of other stuff, let's talk about drinking with rugby because you said you couldn't go crazy in SA, which is understandable. Probably don't want to go too crazy just in case you get lost and fingered by some bloke in a dark alley. What's your standout rugby drinking night? Is there one?
Not really, to be fair. I've not really had like too many rugby nights out, to be fair. Because like I was at uni, obviously, before Christmas, and that was sort of ruined because of COVID. So there was no proper drinking there, apart from a few bits here and there. And so, yeah, so nothing major, really. I've not really had too much of a crazy time.
Have you not had your PAVS initiation?
Yeah, I've had the bus back from Sambatch.
Oh, that would have been...
What was the song?
I had the... I don't know if I'm allowed to say, to be fair.
I wouldn't divulge too much, no, but what was your song?
Ah, what was it? I think it was Country Road.
Nice. I mean, for those who don't know it, do you want to give us a quick...
I'm not saying... I've already done my initiation.
Yeah. Tom's sat here, not done his.
Yeah, I know. It's coming. It's coming. I thought being shit at rugby would get me out of a bus trip, but evidently it's not going to... I need to get a song in my head for that. Before we go into some really shit questions from the public... So you're a barber now.
Yeah.
Did you start that during the pandemic so you didn't actually have to do any work, or is this something you actually want to do as a kind of career choice?
So I'll go through what happened. Basically, I thought about doing it in year 11, just as like a brief, when you're just going through sort of your options of what you want to do, and then didn't really come across my mind. Went to school, did my A-levels, then went to uni after New Zealand. And I was at Manchester Met, just had a bit of a shocker, really. Just didn't really like it. It wasn't my cup of tea. And then my mum's a hairdresser, and I spoke to her again and said, like, I don't think it's my cup of tea. So she said, like, you can't just do nothing. You've obviously got to find something you want to do. So I went and I've worked with my dad for a few weeks. He's a builder. Just thinking about all stuff. And I was like, oh, why don't I try barbering at about Christmas time? And mum was like, yeah, go for it. So I've gone for it and I'm full swing on a 4-week intensive course at Citatong and Sherwood.
And so did I see that you started that today? Was that today or yesterday?
Yeah.
Oh,
Yeah, I'm full swing now. I'm going for it.
Full swinger.
Apprenticeship in at Dudley's Hair and Beauty, which is my mum's shop. Mum's salon. So it's
amazing. I mean, we look at Phil. I mean, there's no point talking about hairdresser with me, but we look at Phil. He's pretty bog standard bloke in many ways. That was quite camp for you, Phil. But what would you, if you come in and was like, I don't know what I want, because there'll be tracks like this. I don't know what I want. Do something to me, Ed. What are you doing to Phil's Ed?
Oof. I don't know. There's not much you can do, to be fair.
Grow the fringe out so you hide some of the forehead. There's one. No,
what do you usually get when you go?
I go in and I say, do whatever you can to hide the receder and don't make my ears look any bigger. That is pretty much...
Can't be your barber's a miracle worker.
Well, yeah. To be honest, mate, if I had a choice, I would have a mullet. But the wife won't have any of it, even though the first time we got together, I had a mullet. So, yeah, so... double standards, isn't she? Unbelievable.
Incredible. Incredible. I mean, moving on to questions from the public, we did actually have someone with a question about the mullet, and it isn't something we agree with at Palspod, and probably Pavia's is a wider club. But a bloke called Kean.
From training. Sorry. The Mansfield lad, Tom.
I've not looked at it, so I just saw it, and I took offence to the question, really. But it was, when you're going to shave your shit mullet. But I don't think it is shit.
I don't really know when I'm going to get rid of it, to be fair. I don't think I'm going to grow it any longer. But, I'm just going to see how it goes, to be honest.
I think you might need to tidy from one mullet lover to another. I think you might need to
one mullet lover to another.
Start straightening the back.
What, you reckon just you want to straighten the back?
Oh, yeah. Oh, you've got to straighten it, mate.
I was thinking about going more curly.
You'll look like a poodle, though. If you go straight,
yeah.
It's like it depends on what ear you get pierced, isn't it? So if you don't straighten, the mullet, people might ask questions. I think you could straighten it and look good.
Nah, I think it'd look really bad straight.
Don't let Keane get in your head. Don't let Keane get in your head. Fuck him. I mean, no. Look at the state of Keenan. Now I know who it is. Jesus Christ. Why is he talking about anything like that? My word. Frosty tips and fucking tiny tits. Phil, can you ask the question from Ollie Hansen? Just because I've heard your accents, and I think you're really good at accents. So can you please answer the first question?
So Ollie Hansen wanted to know how much you receive royalties from The Simpsons every time the German exchange student's on, which I believe his phrase is, "Oh, don't make me run, I'm full of chocolate." Is that good?
That was fucking class. Do it again.
No, come on. Let's not follow a donkey. Talking about donkeys, I'll be handsome. Give us that one.
I was chatting it. None.
just chatting it.
I mean, you do look a bit like him.
Without sounding horrible, you've made a lot of comparisons in this script, Phil.
I have, but he's just, you know, like we talk about Rimmo being a generic
default
character on any computer.
You say Lockie's a generic blonde fat child.
The glove fits.
Oh, that's not very nice, is it? When you're in Japan,
yeah,
did you find the toilets life-changing or arousing?
Both,
that's for sure. Yeah. What happened in the toilets for it to be arousing?
Oh, Tom, do you not know about toilets in Japan?
I don't know about toilets.
So basically, it's just a regular toilet, but with buttons on the side. So you're thinking, what on earth do these buttons do? It's just the flush button, and that's it. But anyway, these buttons, you can press them and they'll fire like a stream of water onto your bumhole to clean it.
Oh my god.
So like move it, you can change the temperature, the power, that you can
change the fucking temperature.
Every toilet. It's unbelievable.
Oh, that's dangerous. So you don't want to like shoot boiling water up your bum, oh dear.
Yeah, I know. It doesn't get too warm. It doesn't get too bad, to be fair. We try good testing and see what it was like.
I can just imagine you and your mate stood around the toilet taking one at a time. Right, you press this button this time. So no, was it just water shooting? There was no like equipment that came out or anything like that?
Like, I don't even know where the water came from. It just fired out.
So when you press the button, a little thing comes out the back of the toilet?
Yeah.
Tom, it's an absolute game changer, mate.
It took us about to sort of like get the boss to actually do it, and then we did it, and it was just unbelievable.
They don't have skid marks in Japan. It's ridiculous.
Japan tour paviors. Get us all out there. Get me on a fucking... Why don't we have them in England? I guess it'd be day, innit?
I've not been to Japan. I managed to spend... I had a couple of goes. I had 6 hours in Singapore on a changeover, and they had some in that airport. And I went once. I came back with a massive smile on my face. I was like, oh, I'm going to have to eat some more and go again.
Just don't poo. Just go and sit on... Anyway... This isn't a question, this is a fact. For someone that's been typing into us, got on my tits a bit, B_Sadri, you've got no chat, mate. No point, your questions are boring, so don't bother messaging again. You'll probably switch off now, but that's fine. Let's take a quick break, because I need another wee, and then Phil will get his package out for you, which, from what I've heard, is sparkling clean. Hello, Goat here. So as I'm having a wee break on Wednesday night when recording with Lochie, I'm recording on Friday morning to give, well, Friday afternoon to give you a little bit of an update about what stuff's going on. So as we're edging closer to being allowed to sit in the same establishment, we're looking at doing some live shows, which would be class. We're looking to get some players and coaching staff from other clubs onto the pod. Currently in some talks with maybe some big talkers from some of the other teams. As you've just heard, I've learned about Japanese toilets, right? And I did a little bit of research, and so I'm going to slide a new fact into this for you. Might not happen every week, probably not going to get a fact from me every week, but did you know Japanese toilets are winterized, which means instead of in the winter dropping your cacks and sitting down and having a cold bum, the toilet seats are warmed. Honestly, this is blowing my mind. I want to thank Lockie and Phil for informing me of this, and their sparkly clean bum holes. So if you want anything from PazPod, let us know. Get in contact with us on Instagram. Remember to follow us on Instagram and Facebook as well. We are on Spotify, Apple, Google Podcasts, anywhere you'll find a podcast. Normally you'll find us, and we are obviously a YouTube show as well. So give us a subscribe on them. And if you can hit the 5-star rating or the thumbs up on YouTube, that's going to help us grow the Pavs Pod. See you later. So, Phil, do you want to get your package out?
Let's. So, Lockie, I'm sure you've watched a couple of episodes of this because you've been furloughed for like the last 10 months. We'll start with red or green?
Green.
Favourite alcoholic beverage?
Bottle of Corona.
Oh, very specific, I like it. UK or NZ?
NZ.
Augustus Gloop or Bruce Bogtrotter?
Augustus Gloop.
Favourite Welbeck alumni?
It's Worksop.
Sorry, that's what I mean. I've actually written.
As in, like, who I...
Who was the favourite person you went to school with, mate, in English?
George Stevenson.
George Stevenson, interesting choice. Not really, George. Best player you've played against?
George Mine.
I was about to say, is that the guy who sings Living in a Vila Loca? But it's not, is it? which Pavis team member is most likely to get serious jail time?
Ollie Hansen.
Wow. And Jonty or Jim?
Jonty.
Oh, I don't know. Forward picking Jonty. Oh, why? We need a reason for that. Anytime Johnny gets picked, I want to know the reason.
It's just quick fire. I'll back my decision.
So no reasoning, just
I don't know. Plus Jim makes us run more, so
yeah, he's a bit keen, isn't he, sometimes? Yeah. I mean, Jonty's keen, he just doesn't deliver. Phil, which memory do you want to take?
I'll take best. Lockie, what's your best rugby memory?
Probably beating rugby school at home, playing for Stanford.
It's a notch, isn't it?
Nice. Oh, any reason behind it being the best one?
They're unbeaten at the time. We was having a pretty all right season, and we just had a good game. And just all my schoolmates, one of the like last year at school, and yeah, just a good atmosphere and good game.
It's not bad, not bad thing to have on the notch from the bedpost, I guess. Before I ask you the worst thing, you're doing that thing with the pen, right? I've been trying to do that for years since I was in school. For those on YouTube, you know what I mean. If you're on Spotify, fuck off. You should have watched YouTube. But I still can't do that. 27, still can't make the pen roll.
You need to get practicing. It's all about practice.
Well, I'm not doing the 5K Saturday, Phil. Got my pen. I'm not doing it. Lockie, what's your worst rugby memory?
Playing for Leicester Academy and getting concussion and missing a whole week of games.
Oh, how did you get concussion this time? It wasn't a gazebo falling in your head again, or...
Basically ran into contact and I just got I can't remember if it was a high tackle or not, but I just got hit in the head and then missed the week playing with.
didn't work.
That's the thing. I drop it loads as well, so I'll put it down. Yeah, probably just my concussions, to be fair. I've had probably three, but it's always a bad time, so.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like you get it just so you can have a week off. You actually get it. And yeah.
Thanks,
Dad. Miss out some good rugby. So for those who listen to Mole's episode, we picked a Lions back line and we're getting a bit closer, and word has it Gatlin listens to the pod. So we might have a bit of influence here. So Lockie, me and Phil have all picked our Lions forward pack. I mean, I've got a lot of names in some of my positions I'm yet to be decided for. So Phil, do you want to start us off? And run through.
If we name two props each. I've got Tad Furlong and Wyn Jones.
Exactly what I've got.
Yeah, I think they pick themselves, don't they, this year?
Yeah, they've...
Has anyone written down any England props?
No. I was tempted, but I didn't.
Good, nice to see.
I think the only person I'd take, if it was a normal South Africa, normal Lions tour, just for... the tourist side of things, you take Joe Marler just for the piss up in the midweek.
Yeah,
absolutely. But apart from that, sadly, I don't think anyone's getting anywhere near the. There'll be some that go, but that'd be.
Vunipola probably go, won't he?
Mako, to be fair, Mako will go. All right, hooker. Lockie, what you put?
Ken Owens.
Yeah.
Samesies.
Wow. Front three picked themselves. There's anyone else? Or Jamie George's. And I mean, Luke Cowan-Dickey, people have spoken about. He's had a right season, but well, probably not the starting hooker for the Lions, unfortunately. This is where I think people might disagree with people here. Maybe in the second row. What are we looking at second row then, boys?
I went for Wyn Jones and Itoje.
Phil?
I went for Itoje, but that's got a big asterisk next to it, and Henderson.
See, I've done the same. I'm not asterisk Marrow. Why have you asterisked Itoje?
Because I thought it was pretty garbage in the Six Nations.
Yeah, I get that.
Well, he wasn't garbage. That's harsh. But he couldn't give away. He basically played the tippo role and gave away a load of penalties.
Yeah, he is very keen around the breakdown. He does like to try and hassle the nine on a box kick. But I think Gatland probably enjoys that, to be fair, because it's always milliseconds, isn't it, more than it is clear and obvious. I've also put, if he's fit and we're raring to go, I don't think he will be, but Joe Launchbury, just because I just think he's a talent that I think England miss at the minute. And I think probably could have a shout. But I don't know. There's a few out there. I know. Anyway, let's just move on because there's loads of names that we can run through and say maybe. Back row. Lockie, what are you saying?
First. Underhill 6, Curry 7.
Oh. That's interesting. I've got a plethora, so Phil, I'll let you go first.
So I've got Tipperick at 6 and Curry at 7.
Really? So I've got got a few names. I've got Underhill. I think Hamish Watson's got a massive shout. So I think he was quality. CJ, maybe we'll get in. Curry, and again, if Laws is fit, I think Gatland quite likes Laws's kind of big hitting pressure on, which is probably going to help against the Saffers just because of how they play. And then 8, what were we saying for 8?
Stander.
Falatau.
Yeah, I've gone Falatau.
That's interesting. Also, I've just looked at Falatau wasn't mentioned.
Oh, so you've Googled and copied?
No, just listed names.
Right, okay. I think Falatau is probably quite an easy 8 pick.
Yeah, I think you're right. I'll give you that.
It's not going to be Billy, is it?
Nope. Although he is looking really good in the championship.
So is Max Trimble.
I actually had, if it wasn't CJ Stander 8, I thought Underhill can play 8.
Yeah, he's a better choice at 8 than flipping when we tried Curry at 8 as for England. Not an 8 at all, not an 8. Well, I think we're pretty screwed on there, all of us. So front three was Wynn Jones, Ken Owens and Furlong pretty easy. Everyone whacked in a Itoje and it was between Wynn Jones and Henderson. But I mean, it's Gatland, so it's going to be Alan Wynn Jones, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's be honest.
I've also put Richie in there on the back row.
Who?
Richie, the Scottish flanker.
Yeah.
He had a good Six Nations.
That's the thing. There's a lot of people outside of England that had a good Six Nations. But it's just how you fit them in. And I guess Gatland won't pick on just form, will he? He'll pick on the fact that we're playing South Africa and it's a different kettle of fish completely. But I like that. I think I'll email over that bunch of names to Gatland and we'll see that announced on Sky Sports in a few weeks, I guess. Hopefully we'll get credited for it, but
probably not.
I doubt it. I mean, we text, but I text more than he replies. So there we go. Thanks for coming on, Lot. It's been good to talk to you. And we'll see you at training tomorrow.
Awesome.
So that was Lockie. Good lad, funny lad. Interesting that we were quite all linked in with the same Lions pack at the end there.
Yeah, well, I don't, yeah. It kind of picks itself, doesn't it? Really, forward pack. But yeah, we'll see what Mr. Gatland does next week.
Yeah, next week after one of the two. So the club, we've got the we had the pleasure yesterday of sitting in the marquee for a second week in a row. Bar's looking good, so hopefully, I know the club are looking at opening up a bit more suitable times for people to enjoy themselves.
Yeah, I think the club's, you know, trying to sort of increase the footfall at the bar, but also help people out who, you know, want to get out and do something. And most people spend Saturday afternoon up at the club. So I think the idea is to open sort of mid-afternoon on a Saturday for a handful of hours and to try and get some kind of interaction going at the club again, because I think people are missing it. So I think that's the plan. We haven't got any definitive times or dates, or me and Tom haven't remembered them. so we'll let you know that next week, hopefully. But I think it's a good idea during May to get people back up to the club.
Definitely. And I know sometimes we organise things like bring a picnic, but if you want to come up with the kids and there isn't a picnic organised, you can still bring a picnic because there's enough space.
We've got a few acres there, haven't we?
Yeah, even if you want to bring up some maybe some quick cricket and stuff, and people can just do what they want, or a volleyball net for you and your friends, but just do whatever. And the beer's tasting good, to be fair. Guinness is tasting all right, even out of a plastic glass, which still hurts me, but it is what it is, Mr. COVID. You've got a cricket match coming up.
We have a week Sunday, so Sunday the 9th. We have Knowlton in our next match, which is a lovely little cricket ground over there. So by that point, I'm not sure whether people can come and watch or not. I don't know what the rules are, but just to let people know, we're playing at Knowlton week on Sunday. And all the lads look forward to it. We've got a busy week that week because we play on the Sunday. Then we play West Richard Legion on the Thursday. And then we play Gedling and Sherwood on the Saturday. So it's going to be a busy week. A lot of cricket. But it should be good. Looking forward to it. I can't wait to get another whack.
Another quack. What we will do more interviews. This isn't why I got excited. We will do more interviews. Hopefully the Golden Duck can come back because it's actually quite funny giving someone a Golden Duck. But you saying about playing on the Thursday reminded me, aren't we looking at some Friday night stuff?
Yes, so potential for during the summer break, instead of doing Tuesday and Thursday nights, we'll just do a Friday night and play touch for an hour and then have some beer in the marvellous outdoor marquee that's been put in place. And we'll go from there and see what the numbers are like. And that, I mean, Friday nights might work for some, it might not work for others, but we'll just have to wait up and see how it goes.
If it turns out that only 10 people turn up, then we can just drink.
Yeah, or five and five touch. Depends who you are.
Yeah, drink. If you got anything else you'd like to say before we go?
No.
No wise words?
No.
One day. Right, in that case, see you in a bit.
Bye.
Bye.